Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come.
Welcome to worship, Kathy and I Methodist Church. Today is Communion Sunday, and I remember Jesus said, whoever comes to me will never go hungry. And so I pray today that Jesus himself would satisfy our hunger. My name is Gwyneth Harrison, and I'm pastor here at this amazing church. I'm so glad you're all here. I want to welcome any first-time guests we have with us today, as well as those who are joining us on Facebook Live and YouTube and wherever you may be. So welcome, everybody. If you are a first-time guest, if you fill out one of these Connect cards and these red pads, please pass those down your row. Make sure everybody gets one. We will mail you a distributed to our next dinner or any dinner upcoming. And there are Connect cards in there and prayer cards. You can fill those out and place them in the offering. And this is the chicken pie church supper. Doesn't that look good? I want it now. There is a sign-up sheet on the table outside if you can come help. I don't know whether it's more fun to eat or whether it's more fun to serve. What do you think? I don't know. It's hard to choose. I like both, actually. So please sign up to help, and if not, invite a friend and just come and eat. We have some beautiful items for sale upstairs. Deanna, remind me, where are you, Deanna? What are they called?
Impression
glass?
Depression
glass. Okay, but it makes you not depressed, right? It's actually gorgeous, and there's a whole table of it. And we want you all to have first dibs on it. Before we contact an auctioneer to take the whole set. So if you would like to go up and purchase some individual pieces, just go ahead upstairs and Deanna will make notes and background on some of the pieces if you'd like to. We have a membership inquirer's class today after worship, and I know we have definitely three people attending. Benoit and Diane, I believe, are attending. This is kind of an advanced class. I usually do this in four sessions. We're going to just do it in a couple hours in one session. For those who are really more experienced in Methodism and in the church. So, although you never know, we might spend till dinner time if we get into some kind of discussion. I'll be here. But I envision it'll just be a few hours. So, if anybody would like to attend that, even if you're already a member, all are welcome. We have a church visioning retreat on Saturday. I think that's in 3 weeks. So, 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. And if you're one of those people who has homework, and you haven't done your homework yet for this retreat, please get that done as soon as you can. And I'm one of them. Irving emailed me and said, have you done your interview yet? No, I have not, but I will.
Have we decided where it's going to be?
It's going to be right here. Okay. We're going to have that here. So that we may have other visioning retreats elsewhere, but we're going to have this first one here. Thank you. And Palm Sunday is on that Sunday, so that's coming right up in just a few weeks. And we're actually going to be using a different kind of palm, and there'll be a little handout about that. And they are, it's really sad to say, but a lot of the palms that the churches buy are made with slave labor. And you know, it's kind of really, do some research on it. It's not very nice. These are eco palms, and they are, they're a tiny bit more expensive, but not drastically, and they're made with all free labor, they're fair trade, and they're more environmentally friendly too, so we just thought we'd try them. They'll look a little different, and I think they're really beautiful, actually, so we're going to try that out. That same day, Palm Sunday at noon, we're going to have a kids' Easter party. Do you hear that, kids? So So on Palm Sunday, we're going to paint resurrection rocks, and we're going to plant seeds in flower pots with Deanna's help, hopefully. And I'm not sure what else we're going to have, whether we'll do the popcorn or, but we'll talk about it and see what other activities we might want to do, but we'll definitely do those two things. So bring your friends. This is open to the community. And are there any other announcements? Okay. Prepare your hearts to worship as the candles are lit that symbolize the light of Christ among us.
Thank you.
need our candy, don't we? And we also need our poster. Can you take our next little piece of armor there? Okay, kids, we have been learning that we are in a very serious battle, aren't we? And so God's enemy wants to take us out. He wants to get us to stop trusting in God and stop obeying God and stop loving God, right? All those kind of different things. And so God is giving us armor, right? God gives us armor to be able to protect ourselves in this very serious battle, okay? So what are some of the pieces of armor that we've learned about so far? The truth belt. The truth belt, yep, the shield of faith. The shirt of righteousness, and the shoes of peace. That's right. So we have two more to go. And today, we're going to talk about this area. So, do any of you guys ride a bike? Yeah?
Yeah.
So, when you ride a bike, what do you have to wear? Yeah, you should wear a helmet because you know why? Because why?
Because you fall off.
But you don't, I mean, you don't necessarily have to wear a helmet on your shoulders. Your shoulder might get hurt. But if you hurt your head, that could be really, really serious, okay? So you really want, if you're in a battle, you really want to be wearing a helmet, okay? So, but remember, we're talking about an invisible enemy. So a helmet, a bike helmet, is that going to do you any good against an invisible enemy? No, probably not. So God tells us to put on the helmet of salvation. Yeah, you put that right up there. Awesome. There's the helmet. And I don't know what these teeny things are, but this is what the Roman helmets looked like. And they had these little, they have these little plumy things that kind of look like a mohawk coming up out of them. So it's kind of cool. So you know what God's enemy wants us to do? You know how what's inside of our head is our
brain.
And our brain helps us to remember. So you know what God's enemy wants us to do is to forget. He wants us to forget who we are, and that is a child of God. So he wants us to forget that we are children of God, and he wants us to forget that Jesus is our Savior and that Jesus is Lord. He wants to forget all of these kind of things for us to say, you know, I can't see God. I'm only going to trust in things I can see, and I can't see God, so I can't trust in God. That's what God's enemy wants. So we have to put on the helmet of salvation to remember. To remember, that's right. We can't see God, but that doesn't mean God doesn't exist, right? Yeah. So, with the helmet on, there is nothing that God's enemy can do to us. Isn't that cool? So, after we pray, we are going to be able to make a helmet of salvation craft. This is my helmet of salvation. What do you think? Put it on? Okay. What do you think?
Yes.
You like it? So let's pray, kids. This is a repeat after me prayer. All right. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
That you are real.
That you are real.
Even if we can't see you.
Even if we can't see you.
Help us always wear.
Help us always wear.
The helmet you gave.
The helmet you gave.
To help us remember.
Help us remember.
And trust in Jesus.
And trust in Jesus.
Who loves us so much.
Who loves us so much.
Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. All right, kids, you can take this helmet with you and take a piece of candy. You can use that as an example. But I want to see all your helmets after. What's this? Oh, it's a Valentine's gift for me. Thank you so much. So every first Sunday of the month, we are taking an opportunity to talk about mission chairs. And so we have a special offering every Sunday, first Sunday. And so we've learned, I think the first week we talked about Mission Shares go to help retired clergy, like our good friend Jim over here, and Neil and Russ Puppy, and maybe some of you remember pastors before that. And so that's an awesome way that Mission Shares support our retired clergy. Last time we talked about Mission Shares go to UMCOR, and that's our United Methodist Relief Disaster Relief Organization. And our Mission Shares allow UMCOR to be able to say during a disaster, when they're asking for donations, that 100% of the donations go to the disaster. Because churches like us pay Mission Shares, cover the overhead. So today, I want to talk to you about that Mission Shares go to new church starts here in New England and congregational development. How many people knew that? Nobody. Isn't that cool? So Carl knows that. Awesome. So I'm actually the new team leader for the congregational development team in our district, and I'm also on the congregational development team at the conference level. And it is so awesome that we are focusing on looking at areas where we can plant new churches and being able to fund somebody who has those kind of gifts to do a church plant and say, run with it, and support them, give them the resources that they need for that new church plant. The other thing that we're doing is doing retreats like this, Discovering the Possibilities, that's being funded by Mission Shares, so that churches that are alive and active and vibrant, but they just need something to kind of get them to that next step, and that, you know, that may be a number of things, but it often does take some resources, some money. So that's another thing that we're looking at. And then the third, this is harder to talk about, but the other thing is intentionally inviting churches who are at the end of their life to enter hospice care and to die well, and use the resources that are remaining to fund ministries that are being birthed, and rather than just using up all their resources on the, you know, last two or three people who want to try to keep the doors open in the church that they were baptized in. So anyway, it's a wonderful way that our Mission Shares are being used in our conference and in our district and by our very church. So let's see, and I think that's it. But the ushers will now pass the plates for the offering, and the choir will be singing during this time. So.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, there, O precious mountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me.
for you are worthy of all glory, praise, and honor. Use our gifts to show your love in our church, community, and world, that all may come to know you. Through Christ we pray. Amen.
May I first pray? I would like to lift up this for the music today. And especially that flute and violin was just absolutely gorgeous. And it's one of those things where the choir's piece they picked out very last minute, and this goes right along with today's theme. Who do you think did that? Yeah. It wasn't Wendy. It was God working through Wendy, right? Oh, Lord,
hear our prayer.
I also want to lift up a praise that Carl just lifted up, that, you know, we pray and ask for God to provide for us, and God does. So, Lord, hear our praise. Also, another praise is that I gathered together with some other churches from Bath and Brunswick, and they're all excited to do another Easter Sunrise Ecumenical Service. So I think we have 7 churches, and maybe more if we can, you know. So spread the word. If you know of friends in other churches, invite them to contact us, and be down at the waterfront at 6 a.m. So, Lord,
hear
our prayer. I'd also lift up Ryan and recovering neck pain, and that's been a rough week on you. And I think Cheryl, you said, is still sick too. So, for the two of you and all you have going on, Lord,
hear our prayer.
Yes, Carl.
Annabelle's grandmother, they found a lump in her neck, so they're waiting on a biopsy.
So okay, so Annabelle, for your grandmother. Lord.
And also, a friend of mine took his life on Tuesday, Mark Wadras. So prayers for his family.
So prayers for the family of Mark Walker?
Wadras.
Wadras, who took his life on Tuesday. So, Lord. And for the work of the Mi-Coos Community Alliance, that we have a long way to go. And I've just looking at the news, it looks like the storm that we didn't get too badly here got hit pretty badly south of us on the coast, and a lot of families affected, still without power, and there's been some fatalities, and so just lift up our whole coastal area after the storm. And also, I heard there was an avalanche in California. I don't know if anybody's followed that. But gosh, California has just been hit with one thing after another. So just lift them up. No, Lord. Let's see the Spirit of Grace. God of love and God of power, you are our strength, you are the joy of our salvation. And Lord, you hear when we shout for joy, and I know that brings such happiness to your heart. But you also hear our cries of pain when we feel lost and distressed. Remind us, Lord, that you are the one who formed the mountains and the trees and the oceans, so surely you can provide us with the abundant grace for every need. Strengthen us, Lord, to not take our eyes off the Christ, off the cross, where you, Lord Christ, are, that we might receive your abundant grace. And as we see that you are no longer on the cross, that we might see you glorified in and through us, your people who pray together, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Instead of reading the two scriptures today, Chelsea and I are going to do a drama based on Numbers chapter 21 and John chapter 3, and they're both printed in your bulletin. You getting ready for bed there, little one? It's time for you to go to sleep now.
Okay.
It's way past your bedtime.
Mom, would you just tell me the story about the snakes again?
Are you sure you want to hear about the snakes right before bed?
It is a kind of scary story, but the way you tell it is not so scary.
All right, but just this one story, and then you need to go to sleep, okay?
Okay, I promise.
All right, many thousands of years ago, God had rescued our people from the mean Egyptians.
Were they like the bullies at school?
That's right, and God saved our people from the bullies. But he brought them into a place that sometimes seemed even worse than getting bullied. It was a place they had to depend on God for everything, even food and water. Well, they were supposed to be going to the promised land where there would be lots of yummy food. But then their leader Moses started heading back the way they came. He said it was a detour, but to them it just seemed stupid.
Seems pretty stupid to me, just like having to eat broccoli.
Well, that was really the problem. They didn't like the food God was serving out there in the desert. Dry bread called manna. They wanted steak and ice cream.
Me too. Can I have steak and ice cream for dinner tomorrow?
We'll talk about that another time. But instead of trusting God that he had all this worked out, they began whining and saying life with the bullies was better. And they didn't want to depend on God at all. What do you think God thought of that?
I guess he wasn't any pleased too.
That's right. So God sent venomous snakes to bite them. And then they realized they had been very naughty and they asked Moses and God to forgive them.
Did God take the snakes away?
Well, they asked God to take away the snakes, but I guess that wouldn't have really helped them depend on God, which is what God wanted them to learn. But God had another plan. You know your shrinky dinks that you make model, what are they? Ballerinas, that's right. And, well, God told Moses to make a model snake. And he made it out of a metal called bronze. And God told Moses to put the model snake up on a pole.
So that made the snakes scared and leave?
No, the snakes paid no attention. They kept right on biting people, and anyone who was bitten would soon die.
I don't like this story. Can we tell a different one?
Now, hold on. That's not the end of the story. You know this story. God told the people that if anyone was bitten by a snake, all they had to do was look at the model snake and they wouldn't die. It was kind of like God sent a divine venom to overpower the snake venom. So when someone was bitten and was sure to die, if they just looked at the bronze snake, they wouldn't die. They would live.
That's cool. I mean, it's not exactly what they had asked for, but...
But maybe that was better because they had to trust in God this way. If God just removed the snakes, they wouldn't have to trust in God and would probably just go back to whining.
Well, it is a cool story.
But you know what's even cooler?
What?
Jesus told this story when he was talking to a guy who was kind of clueless to help him understand God better.
Really?
Yeah. Jesus had just been talking to this guy, Nicodemus, I'll call him Nick, about eternal life and needing to be born again. And the guy just wasn't getting it. So Jesus told him that it was just like what God did with the snake. Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so I, the Son of Man, must be lifted up on a pole, so that everyone who believes in me will have eternal life. What pole do you think Jesus was talking about?
The cross?
That's right. You mean, oh, go ahead.
You mean Jesus? Jesus turned into a snake when he was on the cross?
No, Jesus didn't turn into a snake when he was on the cross. Jesus just used the story to help Nick understand. You see, it's like all of us have been bitten by a venomous snake, and that makes us kind of crazy. And that's why we do naughty things and why we don't do the good things we know we should. We call it sin, but it's just like a snake bite. And it's just a matter of time, but we'll all die from that snake bite. And that's why God sent Jesus to be lifted up on a cross, so that if anyone believes in him, they won't die from the snake bite.
Kind of like magic?
No, not magic, because with magic, people try to control God. God isn't tame like that. It's more like a gift. God gave his son Jesus as a gift, and he wants us to receive that gift through believing and trusting in him.
And then he won't die and will live forever?
That's right. But it's even more than that. When we trust in Jesus and believe that he died for us on the cross, a whole new life begins for us. We are no longer naughty people. We're good people. And then slowly we start acting like who we are. So we start wanting to do good things instead of naughty things. And then Jesus told Nick why God did all of this for us. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life.
I love Jesus.
And he loves you too, sweetheart. Well, that's a great place to start our prayer time now so we can get you to sleep. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Give her a hand. Begin our Lent series following Jesus through the Gospel of John, and I thought with the, today's scripture theme, you might enjoy this cartoon. St. Patrick driving the snakes out of Ireland. St. Patrick's Day is in just a couple of weeks. That is a myth, though, by the way, that there were snakes at St. Patrick's Day in Ireland. But most people in the time of Moses didn't like snakes any more than the people in Ireland or any more than we do. My kids are an exception to the rule, many of you know that. But even if somebody really loves snakes, if you're out camping, like the folks, the Israelites who were out camping in the wilderness, even if you like snakes, you don't want to run into a poisonous snake while you're camping, let alone lots of them. And so the people understood the snakes as God's judgment, that they realized that they had been very unfaithful to God, and they were complaining and making things difficult on Moses and full of doubt. But the snakes, they sensed as God's judgment, but I think we see through the story that they're actually God's method of salvation. And this crisis brought them back to God to help them to trust in God when they were beginning to lose faith. And, you know, when they prayed, the people just wanted God to take away the snakes, right? But God wanted to teach his people to trust him even when they're surrounded by venomous snakes. So what conditions do we long for God to take away? What kind of snake bites have we been getting? I mean, there are lots, right? I mean, doubt and fear and job issues or no job or worry, addiction, family quarrels, relationship problems. I mean, how many snake bites do we have even just in this room, right? And so when the snakes start biting, we pray, right? We ask God, please take away the snakes. Does God hear our prayers?
Yes.
Did God hear the prayers of the Israelites who were praying for God to take away the snakes? Of course he did. But if God had just taken away the snakes, they wouldn't have learned to trust God. And so God didn't answer their prayers the way they wanted, but God answered their prayers in the way they needed. So God had Moses make a model of a replica, if you will, out of bronze of a venomous snake and affix it to a pole. And then he instructed the people, if they just looked up at that bronze snake after they had been bitten, that they would be cured. The bronze snake wouldn't scare away the snakes, like we talked about in the drama, and it didn't prevent the snakes from biting. But looking at the model snake would work like kind of an antidote, so that the bite wouldn't be fatal. And so God was essentially asking them to face their fears and to trust God. So God was asking them to look into the eyes, directly into the very eyes of that which was causing them the most fear. I mean, is anybody here scared of snakes? Yeah, I got a few hands here. I mean, and some of them are real phobias, right?
Yeah.
And so think of your worst possible fears, like that snake phobia, and God is asking you to face it and look at it and trust God. So what kind of snake bites have we been getting? Addiction, fear, worry, self-hate. Yeah, all these kind of things are like snake bites. And the venom from the bite is like coursing through our blood, slowly poisoning us. You know, we might try a painkiller. Ryan, you've been on some painkillers this week, right? I mean, you know, I mean, that's even Tylenol and Advil. I mean, I've, you know, occasionally, you know, but for things, but painkillers, they don't cure you. They just numb the pain for a while. I think that's one of the reasons why we have such a huge opioid issue. It's a painkiller. But it's only temporary. Now, God's antidote in the wilderness only worked for literal snake bites and only for a temporary period of time, right? But what we need is an antidote for all of our snake bites, all of our sin, all of our brokenness. And we need it not just occasionally, but continuously. So this is what Jesus is trying to explain to Nicodemus. He says to Nick, as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. And we can't just put a Band-Aid on a rattlesnake bite, right? We need something much more radical. And we need a miraculous antidote that can actually reverse the work of the venom that is in us. Jesus claims he is that antidote. Isn't that amazing? So the story of the people being saved by looking on this bronze snake is just pointing to or foreshadowing what Jesus would ultimately do for the whole world for all time on the cross. That God would send his Son to die on the cross, that by looking at him in faith, we might receive that antidote and actually start moving from death to life. Now, the recovery takes a long time, though. Prayerfully, none of you has been bitten by a snake. But if you can imagine, you know, our poor sisters and brothers in Florida, for instance, you know, quite a few bites actually happen. And I imagine you don't just go to the hospital, you know, have an injection of the antidote and go home. It's going to take a process. So let me ask you, is salvation instantaneous or is it a process?
Both processes.
Yes. Yes. Yes, it's instantaneous and it's a process. Have you ever read the book or seen the movie Voyage of the Dawn Treader by C.S. Lewis? You all need to read that, okay? That's an assignment. So the whole Chronicles of Narnia series is absolutely amazing Christian work of literature. So the main character is Eustace, a child who is a pain in the neck. They are out on a ship exploring lands beyond Narnia, which is a whole other world. And this Eustace character is prideful, stuck up, selfish, bullying, cowardly, I mean, you name it, he is just a pain in the neck. But through the Jesus character, who is a lion named Aslan, Eustace has a dramatic conversion experience. And this is what that's described as. From that time forth, Eustace was a different boy. To be strictly accurate, he began to be a different boy. He had relapses. There were still many days when he could be very tiresome. But most of those I shall not notice. The cure had begun. When we look upon the cross and we turn and trust in Christ, the antidote really does begin to work in us. And we begin to be different people, but we're not different people instantaneously. The snakes still bite us, it still hurts. We still struggle with all kinds of difficulties in life. But the more that we look to the cross, the less those bites can do us harm. Because through Christ, we receive that antidote, that eternal antidote. And we are being renewed from within. Now, you know, when you're getting bitten by snakes, I mean, especially those who are very phobic, it would be pretty hard to say, just don't look at the snakes. You know? Look at Christ. But that's hard, isn't it? When you have something so fearful before you. A friend of mine who was a pastor shared the story of her mom. She was bitten by the snake of blindness. And this friend of mine, her name is Casey, some of you may actually know her. Her mom, one day, she could see, and she woke up and she was blind. All vision gone. And went to the physician who told her, this is a condition that can't be reversed. I'm so sorry, but you are now blind, and we're gonna have to start adjusting your lifestyle. You know, would it be hard for this lady to keep looking at the cross? I mean, now Casey described her mom as having more faith in her little toe than Casey's whole self. So, you know, it must have been traumatic and discouraging, but though she could no longer see, she didn't ask for physical healing, she asked for strength and faith. And so everybody was praying for her faith and for her strength and her courage. And it was very evident that she was keeping her eyes on the cross. And over a year later, she was in church with her husband. Reminds me of Barbara and Jim sitting there. And, you know, because they would hold hands and they were just so cute. And whenever they were singing a hymn, they would stand together and hold the hymnal. Even though she couldn't see anymore, they kept right on doing that. She couldn't see the hymnal, but it was okay. And while she was singing, she received her sight back. You know, totally dumbfounded the doctors. You know, but God always has a bigger purpose in mind than I think we think of. And I wonder if the reason that God healed Casey's mom wasn't for the sake of her mom, but it was for Casey and for others in the church to see that when this woman of God kept looking at the cross and trusting God, that she was really experiencing God's antidote. And that just as Jesus was lifted up on the cross, after his resurrection, he was healed completely. And I think this healing was just a little foreshadowing of that ultimate time when we will truly see Christ face to face. And so, you know, looking upon the cross isn't just a one-time experience, is it? It's not just, you can say, oh, well, I was saved on the date of and I wrote it in my Bible. You know? Every moment, every day, we need to keep looking at the cross and continue receiving that antidote, which is the love of Christ. In a few minutes, I'm going to invite you to come forward to receive Holy Communion. But as you receive, before coming to the station, I invite you just to come in and stand before the cross here and look upon Christ in faith. Name your snake bites. Feel the venom coursing through you, whatever that might be, of doubt and grief and all of our brokenness. Take as long as you need. And then just say, I trust you, Jesus. All are welcome to receive Holy Communion. Is there anybody who's not welcome to receive Holy Communion? No. And so prepare our hearts now to receive Holy Communion with a time of confession. And let's join in a time of silence as we confess those snake bites and our own struggles to trust in the Lord. Here is the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Now Jesus said to the crowds following him, I am the bread of life. All who come to me shall not hunger. All who come to me shall never thirst. And Jesus is just as present at this table here today as he was when he was speaking to those crowds so many years ago. Through this meal, we meet Jesus. And Jesus satisfies our true hunger. I think Jesus perhaps gave this ritual not to disciples strong in their faith, but those of us who are struggling to remember who we are and to whom we belong, those who struggle with fear and doubt and impatience in the wilderness. We are so easily discouraged. Jesus gave this ritual to fill us with his grace to strengthen our faith with food from heaven. And so at the Last Supper, Jesus shared with his disciples, he took bread and he gave thanks. And he gave the bread to his disciples and he said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup. And he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The next day after the supper, Jesus was crucified. lifted up on the pole in the wilderness, lifted up on the cross, just like he said he would be. But in 3 days, Jesus was then lifted up in a new way. 3 days later, Jesus was raised to new life, forever defeating death. And he offered his disciples and offers us to join him in this hope, to be raised to new life with Jesus. O Lord our God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may know the forgiveness and grace of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit filling us to overcome our fear and lift us up with Jesus. Strengthen our faith now as we receive your heavenly food. For you, God, gave your only begotten Son, and whoever believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Look upon the bread of Christ, the body of Christ, trusting in God for salvation in his name. Look upon the Christ. And look upon the blood shed for us, for our healing, to give us that antidote that we so desperately need to strengthen us to live as faithful disciples. The table is ready. Servers, please come forward, and all may come forward as the ushers direct. praise you for your healing, for your forgiveness, and for the renewal of our faith. As you've offered yourself to us, may we offer ourselves to others in your love and power, knowing you are the one who lifts us up. Let's now sing together, Lord, I lift your name on high. Go now, knowing yourselves lifted, lifted high, and go lifting the name on high that others might know his love as we do. Go in peace. Amen.